Hello, wrestling fans, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. We have a lot of exciting action coming up. We have exciting interviews telling you about things that have happened in the past and things to look forward to in the very near future, plus live action in the ring. To tell you about it, our guest commentator, the very knowledgeable young man, Joel Watts. Joel, you've been doing a tremendous job here lately. A lot of the fans have commented, and we're grateful to them for that and grateful to you for your knowledge.
Thank you very much, Boyd. It's going to be another exciting hour, as Boyd said. And right now we're going to go to ringside with my father, Bill Watts, who has an interview with Hacksaw Butch Reed and Buddy Landell, and he also has a special announcement.
Last week here on Mid-South Wrestling, a match in which Reed and Landell were involved in, it seems like the sport of kings has lowered itself to the sport of hoodlums. You got two-by-fours involved, we got steel chairs involved, tennis rackets, and chains and dog collars. It's all there. And I think what happened to Sonny King, and we don't know the extent of his injury, but what has happened to Sonny King is the last straw. I don't know what the next step could be, but that somebody may be critically injured or lose their life here on Mid-South, and we don't want to be a part of that. We'll join last week the closing moments of this tag team battle that turned into a gang war.
Cornette seems to be getting a little bit excited at this point. I certainly hope he doesn't try to interfere in any way. Oh, he just pulled the top rope on Hacksaw Duggan. Ron West calls for the bell, a disqualification.
Look, Cornette's kicking Duggan.
And Hernandez just waylaid Hacksaw Duggan. Here comes Sonny King. Sonny King with a tremendous headbutt. A diving headbutt.
Hacksaw Duggan's got Cornette in his sights. Cornette looks like a track star and he's running.
Duggan's going after him. No.
You can see the Midnight Express at the bottom of the screen. It's the Midnight Express out. The Midnight Express. Duggan's got away from them.
Meanwhile, Landell and Reed are now teaming up on the dog. They've got Dog in a lot of trouble. What's Landell doing? Here comes Duggan with a board. Duggan's coming with a board. He's going after him. He's going after everybody now. He's clearing the ring with that board.
Hacksaw Jim Duggan's got the two before. Landell's got his feet. Hernandez has got the two before. Ray Hernandez has got the two before. Reed's going up top. We've got more action than we can cover, ladies and gentlemen. We've got more action. Hernandez
looks as if he doesn't know who to knock out with that board.
Hernandez.
Sonny King.
Hernandez with a vicious blow. The two before. Sonny King. He has Sonny King with that board. Hernandez is working over Sonny King with the board. The referee's trying to restore some sort of order.
Here comes Landell now. They're teaming up on the dog. They've obviously got Sonny King hurt. He is hurting bad. He's been hit three times across the shoulder area with that 2x4. And now Reed's got Duggan up. He pile drive Reed. And here comes Dog with that chain.
Jay White leaving the chain. Everybody's leaving the ring.
Junkyard Dog has got that chain and they want no part of it.
In that gang war where Sonny King was badly injured, a 2x4 was used and a steel chain. And in the match prior to that, this tennis racket that Jim Cornette has made famous, and a couple of weeks before that, a steel chair. I want you to see the pain and agony that happened to Sonny King before we make this announcement. We're here back in ringside. We were going to have another match, but we've canceled that. As you can see, Sonny King is in a lot of pain. Ice down his shoulder.
Hey, I don't know what's going on here in Mid-South lately. Ray Cornette, since it's been here, things are just getting a little bit out of hand. Now, nobody asked Sonny to come out and lay himself down the way he did. But I'm one glad that he did it. And Sonny, if there's anything that I can do, man, if there's any way I can help you, just let me know. And what we're going to take care of is up here with Cornette, his stooges, Reed, Landell. Everybody seems to be ganging up. But they're not the only people that band together. Right now, Junkyard Dog, Sonny King, Hacksaw Duggan, Magnum TA, Terry Taylor, and a bunch of others are going to join together like nobody has joined together in Mid-South before. And we're going to clean things up around here.
See, this man, the one that started me out. 7 years ago, Sonny King started me out, and he stood behind me while I was going out to Mid-South area. Now I'm back. Butch Reed and everybody else don't make no difference if you bring your brothers and sisters out. I'm going to knock the devil out of somebody because I'm going to protect not all of me, because the guy just looking out for me, too. I'm sick of all this mess. Yeah, come on, man. It don't make no sense, man.
He's iced down, and we got to get him out of here. Get him to the hospital.
Well, they try to slide him over.
Looks like a dislocation to me, man. I don't know.
Huh?
It looks like it's dislocated.
Best thing to do is try to get him to the doctor, man. Come on, sir. Don't try to pull him up.
I think what has to be done is Mid-South has to take a strong stand about the boards and the chains and the chairs. A lot of courage displayed by Sonny King. Professional wrestling is a violent sport, and there's not a lot we can do to control that. When you have tacticians and skilled athletes out there, they're going to find ways to shade the rules. But Mid-South is going to make a statement and make it stick that in the Mid-South area, anybody that brings a two-by-four to the ring, a chain to the ring, a tennis racket to the ring, or a steel chair to the ring, and hit somebody with it, they're going to be fined $10,000. And since Jim Cornette doesn't seem to be bothered by monetary fines since his mommy helps him out, if Cornette is responsible with a tennis racket, we'll suspend him. But that's just what's going to happen.
Hey, you know what I think? It's about time you and Mid-South got smart, Bill. Watch out, understand? Because these idiots that bring these foreign objects to the ring are not real athletes at all, you understand? I'm glad you wised up, because we don't do nothing but protect ourselves when that greasy laptop brings this old rusty chain down to the ring. That old Harry Hippie, he always got a 2x4 in his hand. Sonny King, find him too, always bring a steel chair. Busted me in the head not too long ago here on TV. And sure enough, you can find that sissy. I don't care with that old tennis racket. It's about time. All we do is protect ourselves. And matter of fact, I would be North American champion right now if it wasn't for these weapons right here that stops my progress. And also, it stops the progress of my main man right here, Buddy Landale, the rising star.
Your innocence speaks louder than words. I know that you guys...
Hey, Bill Woods, it's not our fault that we kick the daylights out of our opponents and they get so disgusted that they have to go back in the back and pull out gimmicks like dogs, chairs, or boards. It's not our fault that we come out here, we beat them like dogs, they bring these things out here, we take them away from them, and then we put them out of professional wrestling. That's the price they have to pay.
Well, I want to tell you one thing. You better write this down in your notebook, that these four items, the next guy that brings them to the ring and uses them on his opponent, it's going to cost him $10,000.
I agree with you. Because I'm an athlete, he's an athlete.
Right.
We don't need these things. We take them with the Super Bowl. You understand? Come here, buddy.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back after these messages from the sponsors of Mid-South Wrestling.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next match will be for the Mid-South Television title. Prior to starting that match, however, Steve Dr. Death Williams has requested for us to give him the time to make this statement.
Jim Ross, I should be up here wrestling for the TV champion. I've got the medal. I took it away from Khrushchev, and I beat Terry Taylor. Possession is 9/10 of the law, and I have it.
Well,
Doc, whether you have the medal or you don't, Mid-South Wrestling, Mid-South Wrestling does not recognize you as the champion. Terry Taylor is the television champion.
I should be up here wrestling for the TV champion. I should be wrestling for it. This thing stinks. This whole thing stinks.
Terry Taylor is the television champion, Doc. That's what I'm trying to explain to you. You are not recognized by Mid-South as the champion. Terry Taylor's a champion. He's going to defend his belt here in just a few moments, this medal.
This whole thing stinks. All right. If Terry can beat Khrushchev, I'll give him the medal. But I'm doubtful that he'll beat Khrushchev.
Well, Steve Dr. Death Williams, you heard it, ladies and gentlemen, the same as I did. He is going to give the medal back to Terry Taylor if Taylor can defeat Khrushchev. Ladies and gentlemen, at 303 pounds, standing in the red corner, the Russian sympathizer, Crusher Khrushchev. This television title match, one fall with a 15-minute time limit. Introducing in the blue corner, the Mid-South television champion from Vero Beach, Florida, Terry Taylor.
That's the introduction of a championship match sanctioned by Mid-South for the Mid-South television title, held by the champion Terry Taylor from Vero Beach, Florida, against the challenger from Northern Minnesota, the Russian sympathizer, Crusher Khrushchev. Paul Fergie, the referee, called for the bell, and here's Joel Watts.
Well, here we have another barn burner on Mid-South television. Dr. Death is watching it tensely now as Terry Taylor begins his match with Crusher Khrushchev.
But Joel, he has something at stake because the fans heard in the interview there, as he told Jim Ross, that if Terry Taylor can defeat Crusher Khrushchev, he will give the television championship medal to Terry, the champion.
Yes, that remains to be seen, Boyd. And I've known Doc for a long time, and I certainly hope that he has the intestinal fortitude to give the thing back to Terry if he does win. I think it's wrong of it to be wrong of Steve to be keeping the medal. I think maybe he's being influenced by the wrong people at this time, but there you have it. He said he's going to give it back, and as I said before, that remains to be seen. Taylor and Khrushchev now in a bit of a scuffle. Referee Carl Fergie trying to break it up. It is in the ropes. Khrushchev goes for that right hand, and Terry counters him. Khrushchev complaining about the fist now, but I think he was the one who tried to use the maneuver in the first place. You know, it seems that Doc is doesn't really like either one of these wrestlers too much. You know, we all know of his hatred for Russians, and right now with the controversy over the television medal, he's not too happy with Terry Taylor at this point, but I certainly hope he doesn't interfere in the match in any way, shape, or form. He is still watching at ringside closely and intensely.
Joel, this is a Mid-South Television Championship match for the television title. One fall or 15-minute time limit. You know, in the arenas when a television championship bout is on, it's the first 15 minutes of the match, and this is a 15-minute time limit. All other television matches are for 10-minute duration, but this is a television title match with a 15-minute time limit.
Yes, Grizzly Smith has extended the time limit on it because of the fact that it is for a championship medal here on television. Crusher Khrushchev now saying that he did not pull the hair, but it looked like from at this angle that he might have had a hold of Terry's hair. And you know, whenever you use that hair, it seems to be an extra added type of leverage, you know, and wherever that head goes, the rest of your body has certainly got to follow. Khrushchev's got a rather unorthodox form of an arm bar there. It seems to be stretching out the tricep area of Terry Taylor. Terry now trying to break out of that arm lock before it saps too much of his strength. Looks as if Crusher Khrushchev went to the hair again as a shortcut, but Terry Taylor quickly popped out of it. Terry Taylor with a hammer lock. Dr. Death still watching intensely. He seems to be rooting for Crusher Khrushchev, even though of his dislike for the Russian.
Joel, it seems now in Mid-South Wrestling we're going to see more holds. We're going to see more punishing holds like the full Nelson and also the arm lock and the hammer lock, because the foreign substances and outside objects have been banned. We saw the president of Mid-South Sports Cowboy, Bill Watts, issue the ultimatum of a $10,000 fine for all those tennis rackets, chains, chairs, two befores being brought to the ring. This open trench warfare has to be slowed down some way.
You're 100% right, and there's Terry Taylor with a flying body press. Khrushchev kicks out. You know, also, these two men will be trying to apply a lot more punishing holds with the extra 5 minutes added time limit. That allows for a little bit more time to use your tactical warfare, your psychological warfare, time to wear that opponent down. Crusher Khrushchev now has Terry Taylor in the corner and Carl Fergie trying to break it up, but Khrushchev's just a big powerhouse. And, you know, I know from refereeing, Terry Taylor knocked out of the ring. And Dr. Death is going over. He's got Terry Taylor by the hair, and he has run Terry Taylor's head into that steel pole. He has run it into the steel ring post, and Terry Taylor is hurt. Dr. Death ran Terry Taylor's head right into that steel ring post. And Boyd, it looks as if Terry Taylor has been severely lacerated. Crusher Khrushchev now moving in, trying to attack that laceration.
He's quickly trying to capitalize on that happened at the hands of Dr. Death Williams, who's still on the outside of the ring.
Arm whip into the side, and Terry Taylor appears to be in a predicament. Like I said, Boyd, I've known Dr. Death for a long time, and this just is not him.
Well, he threw Terry Taylor into that steel ring post, and you can see the crimson flowing profusely.
Dr. Death has certainly changed 100% from the person that I knew once. These type of tactics should never be used in any match, much less a title match. I think the taste of the gold has gone to Dr. Death's head. I don't, like I said before, maybe he's being influenced by the wrong people.
Well, the thing about it, we know, and we stated earlier, Crusher Khrushchev, as he's turned his back on America, and of course, Steve Dr. Death Williams, that's America. He doesn't care for Khrushchev, or he doesn't care for Terry Taylor, either one.
Khrushchev applying a chokehold. Carl Fergie trying to break it up now. Khrushchev's got him covered for a two count. A two count, Terry Taylor kicks out. And you know, the loss of blood in a match like this has got to start becoming a factor at this time. Boy, he's got him. He rolled him up. He's got him rolled up. One, two, a two count. And Terry Taylor hit Dr. Death right across the jawbone with a thundering forearm. I'm sure he's got to be pretty angry about going into that ring post. Dr. Death is dazed. Terry Taylor's got him rolled up.
He got him.
A three count. Terry Taylor retains the television championship. And now it's up to Dr. Death. He promised to give that medal back. He promised to give it back.
Terry Taylor is
hurt, but victorious. He is hurt, tired, exhausted. The loss of blood has got to be getting to him by now. Dr. Death, he promised to give the medal back. He's taking it off his neck now. It looks like he hit Terry Taylor right across the forehead with that medal.
And he did not do what he said he would do, Joel, leaving the ring with that medal around his neck. But still, the Mid-South television champion from Vero Beach, Florida, Terry Taylor.
I can't believe it.
And we'll be back for tag team action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling. Mid-South Wrestling is so true to other things in life. Not only earlier did Cowboy Bill Watts, the president of Mid-South Sports, lay the law down, a law with teeth in it. There'd be a $10,000 fine for anybody bringing a steel chair, tennis racket, two before to the ring, a chain. And then the very next match, we saw Dr. Death Steve Williams use an item that you would never think of, that gold medal that belongs to the television champion, Terry Taylor. He gave it to him all right, but in such a manner that I would have never dreamed of. So it always, somebody's waiting for something just outside the rules, but it is a step in the right direction, and I hope Cowboy Bill Watts will put teeth in everything that's detrimental to our wonderful sport of professional wrestling. Let's go to the ring now. Jim Ross for the next match.
This is a tag team match on Mid-South, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. First of all, introducing the team in the blue corner. From Alabama, Josh Stroud and Mike Jackson.
Thank you. That's right. I know I look good. And I know all over TV land, you're anticipating what you're going to see next. So I won't disappoint you. The most awesome tag team in wrestling, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Loverboy Dennis and beautiful Bobby the Midnight Express.
Now, Stan, let me have one man from each team. And you saw the introduction of the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Dennis Condrey and Bobby Eaton, who formed the Midnight Express, managed by Jim Cornette. And he's on the outside of the ring along with his bodyguard, Hercules Hernandez. But Joel Watts, he did not come to the ring with a tennis racket. Did you notice it?
Yes, I noticed, Boyd, and I hope that it will continue as a trend in the future. Josh Stroud with a body press on Bobby Eaton, trying to make it a quick match. Bobby Eaton kicks out, seems a little bit surprised by that maneuver. Midnight Express, of course, a very formidable tag team. They've had a long string of victories here. They are still the Mid-South Tag Champions. They have defeated one of their arch rivals in a loser-leave-town match in Hammond, Louisiana on July the 7th. A very, very unfortunate incident. I know all of the fans really liked it, Rock and Roll Express, but we hope to someday be able to bring the Rock and Roll Express back. They are at this point supposed to be gone for 90 days.
Bobby Eaton in the ring now with a side headlock on Mike Jackson. Jackson from Birmingham, Alabama. His partner on the outside of the ring from Detroit, Joshua Stroud. Eaton now being the aggressor thus far. And here he comes, leapfrogging across Mike Jackson and takes things into his own.
Mike Jackson is, of course, lightning quick. But Bobby Eaton is, of course, a match for anybody in the area of quickness. Mike Jackson now taking it to Bobby Eaton with a flying head scissor and a drop kick. Thunderous drop kick. Bobby Eaton now going for the tag with Dennis Condrey. He's got Mike Jackson and a Boston Crab, and oh, a very painful maneuver there. Dennis Condrey came down across Mike Jackson's back with an elbow while he was in a Boston Crab. Those muscles being stretched out and under impact at the same moment.
Josh Stroud stretching his muscles out, trying to tag his partner Mike Jackson, but unable to reach him.
Hercules Hernandez there, ever present at ringside, keeping an eye on Jim Cornette's back. You know, now that Cornette is without the tennis racket, it's going to be a mystery to see what kind of devious tactics he uses. That seems to be the equalizing force in most of his matches to date. Josh Stroud now coming in with right crosses, trying to take over on Dennis Condrey in a hurry. Dennis Condrey firing back. Dennis Condrey himself is double tough. Joshua Stroud, a strong young man, winner of several bodybuilding contests in the Kansas area. Dennis Condrey now with a tag. He looks like he's setting up for some kind of hold. Very forceful body slam there by Dennis Condrey. Reminds me of those that we saw by Jim Neidhart. Oh, what an excruciating clothesline there. Joshua Stroud was trapped by Dennis Condrey, and there's the three count. That'll be all for Josh Stroud and Mike Jackson.
A tremendous maneuver, and it ended in a victory for the Mid-South Tag Team title holders, the Midnight Express. We'll be back when action continues after this word.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match of Mid-South Wrestling is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. First of all, in the blue corner, weighing 221 pounds from Salem, Virginia, Rick McCord.
And he's fixing to go back there, too. Let me tell you people something. We just proved a little point, and we're fixed to prove another one. You say I need the tennis racket to win a match. Well, we just proved right here in this ring we don't need anything except our own bodies and my mind. But I'm upset about this, and I'm calling my mother's attorneys. There will be a legal way to get my tennis racket back because I don't appreciate for 1 minute having anything taken away from me. Now, the parade of champions continues. 260 pounds, the most powerful human in the world, Hercules Hernandez.
Now you have the arrogant manager, Jim Cornette, introducing his personal bodyguard and top flight grappler, Hercules Hernandez, versus Salem, Virginia's Rick McCord. Joel?
Well, you know, last week, Boyd, we saw that strange hold from the Orient that Jim Cornette has taken the credit for finding. He is a student of professional wrestling history of all types. He has a large collection of videotapes, or so he says, of old matches, and he is an astute student of professional wrestling. Not to mention quite outspoken as well.
Well, he was outspoken there when he mentioned his mother and he mentioned his tennis racket, and of course, the stipulations when the laws were made and teeth were going to be put into it, that other people will be fined $10,000. But in Jim Cornette's case, where he's not a grappler, that if he brings it to the ring, he faces suspension.
Rick McCord with a flying body press, and Hercules Hernandez shows us once again just how powerful he is as he drops Rick McCord across the steel cables. It looks now as if he may be going for that oriental hold. There it is. He is applying it tightly, and Rick McCord is going limp. Rick McCord appears to be going unconscious. His facial color has changed.
And for the second consecutive week, we have seen Hercules Hernandez gain a match with that same hold. We'll be back in just a moment with tag team action, the Junkyard Dog, teaming up with Hacksaw Jim Duggan after this message.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Tag Team Wrestling on Mid-South, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. First, introducing in the red corner, the team of Bad Bob Owens and Hans Schroeder. Ladies and gentlemen, making their way to the ring, the team of Hacksaw Jim Duggan and the Junkyard Dog.
And the music brings to the ring the inimitable Junkyard Dog and his partner from New York State, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, against Hans Schroeder and Bad Bob Owens. In the ring now, representing their team, this is the Dog against Schroeder. Joel?
Well, Boyd, you know, I think it sticks in all of our minds that the tag team match last week between Dog and Duggan and Reed and Landell. It was somewhat of a historic moment, even though the outcome was unfortunate.
And the new rules that have been stipulated and laid down, you see the Dog come to the ring without his ever-present chain that he always brings.
Dog and Duggan they look as if they may prove to be quite a formidable tag team. One's probably capable of giving the Midnight Express a good shot for those Mid-South tag team belts. Dog now with an arm lock on Hans Schroeder. Hans Schroeder, a very large man from Germany. He's quite a good wrestler. Appears to be pulling the Junkyard Dog's hair now, trying for a shortcut. The Dog hits him with that powerful right cross. Junkyard Dog, an extremely strong individual, giving the tag now to Hacksaw Duggan, letting the fresh man in. And Duggan now working extensively on that arm. Duggan now with an arm whip into the side. Turnbuckle and a vicious clothesline. Vicious clothesline to Hans Schroeder. He comes with that high knee across the chin area. An elbow. Duggan is just a very powerful opponent. I certainly feel sorry for anybody who's against that man. Or the Junkyard Dog, for that matter.
I started to add, against that man or against that team, a tremendous team, the big thumper Junkyard Dog again, and his partner, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. I just love to watch them. They're tremendous athletes as well as great grapplers, Joel.
Both of them have that, of course, that background in amateur wrestling and, of course, professional and college football. Both of them extremely powerful, quick-moving men. A lot of charisma. Definitely been a fan's favorite for years.
And Bad Bob Owens came over to put that knee to the back of the Junkyard Dog when he was against the rope. There he goes between the legs of Hans Schroeder, and in comes Duggan.
Duggan now with those powerful chops to the back of the neck of Hans Schroeder, and in comes Bad Bob Owens, who decided that he might just take a little shortcut try and make a name for himself here on Mid-South Wrestling by attacking Dog from behind while the referee's back was turned, but it proved to be no avail. Duggan now with the tag, and there's JYD with that patented thump. Two and three, that'll be all for Bad Bob Owens and Hans Schroeder.
As the winners, their hands being raised in victory, the Junkyard Dog, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. We have more action coming up after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Now we're going to see the Pretty Young Things PYT special by the popular Michael Jackson. And then in action, we'll see Narvel, Austin, and Coco Ware, the Pretty Young Things in action. So watch along with us.
Look, we just come by here to make your day.
Yes, sir, thank you.
Because there's hundreds of thousands of people out there. If they thought that we weren't going to be on this TV show, they would change their TV channel.
That's right.
I guarantee you that.
I want to say something. You know what, dog? I want that director to pay attention to me with his redneck-looking self. Hey, man, why don't you punch the right button, and you're going to be looking at the greatest team in professional wrestling, baby.
This tag team match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. First, introducing the team in the red corner. From Alabama, Randy Barber, and his partner from Chattanooga, Pat Rose.
Where did you come from, baby?
Making their way to the ring, Norvell, Austin, and Coco Ware, the Pretty Young Things.
Now you heard the introduction, and they've seen their own version of the gyrations there, Joel, and the fans in unison here at the Irish McNeil Boys Club as the Pretty Young Things, Norvell, Austin, and Coco Ware, tag team action against Randy Barber in the yellow trunks and Pat Rose from Chattanooga, Tennessee in the purple tights.
Yes, boy, the Pretty Young Things, one of the hot new tag teams to explode onto the Mid-South scene. Both of these men, terrific athletes, lightning quick. Both of them stout, powerful men, low centers of gravity. They really can motor around that ring. Of course, another candidate for the Mid-South tag titles, Pretty Young Things, have met with the Midnight Express, and there appears to be quite a feud building up between these two teams. Coco Ware now with an arm whip. Well, these two men are so fast I could hardly call their action. You know, terrific high back drop by Coco Ware. Norvell Austin now with a right cross to the solar plexus and a high knee across the jaw area. Quick tags there, keeping that fresh man in. They're working on Pat Rose, trying to destroy him pretty quick. High flying body press by Coco Ware. That certainly had to hurt Pat Rose. So Pat goes for the tag with Randy Barber coming in now. Coco Ware showing his form. Tag is made, Norvell Austin in now. You know, Boyd, the thing that's been on my mind ever since this match has begun and the previous ones, the situation between Terry Taylor and Dr. Death Steve Williams. Oh, an amazing body slam by Coco Ware. Had to have knocked the breath out of Randy Barber. You know, I like I said before, Boyd, I've known Dr. Death for a long time, and I just, it's hard for me to believe that he'd use such tactics as to hit Terry Taylor with a TV medal, especially when he was down and hurt. Oh!
Look at that high flying maneuver off. Look at the referee's
second
hand.
Second rope drop kick by Coco Ware. What a powerful young team this Pretty Young Things is.
They gained the victory, and listen to the fans solidly behind them. We'll be back with more after this word from Mid-South Wrestling. Last week, you viewed it, and we've had so many comments. So many people have asked to see it again. It's a fantastic segment of the fantastic ZZ Top and the Sharp Dressed Man. It was put together by a young man of many talents, Joel Watts, so let's watch it again. Fans, we don't have time for another match this week, but they're trying to sign a Mid-South Tag Team title match next week between the Midnight Express and the Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Jim Dugan. What about it, Jim Cornette?
What about it, Boyd Pierce? Have you ever noticed that every time that there's a question around Mid-South Wrestling, you got to come to me to get the answer? Does that tell you something? It tells me that nobody but me knows what's going on. Now, the answer to your question is maybe and maybe not. Because the plain fact of the matter is that old Tight Pockets Grizzly Smith, that cheapskate, is going to have to come up with a whole lot better compensation than he usually does before we'll defend those belts on TV against a couple of guys like that, because they're the ones that bring the boards in the ring. They're the ones that bring the chains in the ring. I got a little dinky tennis racket that never hurt anybody, and they bar me from having it. Legal action is pending on that, but they're the ones that bring those deadly weapons into the ring, so it's going to take a great deal of thought, and it's going to take a great deal of compensation, shall we say, from Grizzly Smith, the matchmaker, before we agree to defend our Mid-South Tag Team titles against a couple of big brutes like that. Does that answer your question?
Okay, no, you didn't give us an answer, but I hope they sign it, because I want to see Hacksaw Dugan and Junkyard Dog against your men. Next week, I hope we'll be able to see it. We will see the NWA Heavyweight Champion of the World, Ric Flair. Until then, for ring announcer Jim Ross, our commentator Joel Watts, I'm your host Boyd Pierce, and thank you so much for viewing. We'll see you next week, same channel on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Hello once again, everybody, and welcome to another exciting hour of Mid-South Wrestling. I'm Jim Ross, and along with Joel Watts, we'll be calling the action here, and it's really going to be an action-packed card. I'm excited just seeing that new opening, and Joel, that was a super job that you'd done on the new opening here for Mid-South Wrestling.
Well, thanks a lot, Jim. I had a lot of fun putting it together. I had a whole lot of help from Ron Toma, a director at KTBS, and I'd like to thank all the wrestlers, of course, for providing the action. And you know, Jim, you're right, it's going to be an action-packed hour today. Our big main event today is between the Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Jim Dugan against the Midnight Express for the Mid-South Tag Team titles, and that is a no disqualification bout.
No disqualification it will be, and when we talk about the rules, we do have some special announcements to make during this hour. And to start things off, let's go to ringside and the president of Mid-South, Cowboy Bill Watts.
You know, when I was watching my favorite sport, wrestling, on the Olympics, the United States 136-pounder in Greco-Roman in a match beat the Canadian 3-0. Then the FILA, the organization governing the wrestling rules, a protest was entered by his coach. They looked at the films, and overnight the 3-0 victory became a 3-3 tie, which he lost on criteria. He lost his chance to go for the gold medal in Greco-Roman due to winning it on the mat and losing it in the boardroom. And I want to say one thing. Mid-South will never reverse a decision one in the ring due to what's on the videotape. Whatever stays out there, that's going to be the final decision. But we found that a lot of fans have reacted, and they're right, that we have been justifying a situation with Steve Dr. Death Williams and Terry Taylor, where Terry won this medal in the Superdome June 16th, the television title. Now, Dr. Death had taken it away from the Russian, and we all thought, and he and Terry were friends, so it's kind of a symbolic deal. But when Terry won the medal, Doc didn't give it back to him. And last week, when Terry was going to wrestle the Russian, Doc said, if you beat the Russian, who I took the medal away from, this time I'll really give it back to you. Let's listen to Doc's own words on this subject.
Mid-South Wrestling does not recognize you as the champion. Terry Taylor is the television champion.
I should be up here wrestling for the TV champion. I should be wrestling for it. This thing stinks. This whole thing stinks.
Terry Taylor is the television champion, Doc. That's what I'm trying to explain to you. You are not recognized by Mid-South as the champion. Terry Taylor's a champion. He's going to defend this belt here in just a few moments, having this medal.
This whole thing stinks. All right. If Terry can beat Khrushchev, I'll give him the medal. But I'm doubtful that he'll beat Khrushchev.
So there you heard Doc make the vow that if Terry could defend the title successfully against Khrushchev, he would give him the medal back. Meanwhile, Terry had also successfully defended the title against Dr. Death, and he'd yet refused to give the medal back. Now, we'll see at the closing moments of this match just how intense Doc has gotten into this TV medal as he tries to make sure you don't beat the Russian. Let's watch the closing moments.
Khrushchev's just a big powerhouse, and, you know, I know from refereeing, Terry Taylor knocked out of the ring, and Dr. Death is going over. He's got Terry Taylor by the hair, and he has run Terry Taylor's head into that steel pole. He has run it into the steel ring post, and Terry Taylor is hurt. It appears to...
Dr. Death ran Terry Taylor's head right into that steel ring post. And boy, it looks as if Terry Taylor has been severely lacerated. Crusher Khrushchev now moving in, trying to attack that laceration.
He's quickly trying to capitalize on that happened at the hands of Dr. Death Williams, who's still on the outside of the ring.
Arm whip into the side, and Terry Taylor appears to be in a predicament. Like I said, Boyd, I've known Dr. Death for a long time, and this just is not him.
Well, he threw Terry Taylor into that steel ring post, and you can see the crimson flowing profusely.
Dr. Death has certainly changed 100% from the person that I knew once. These type of tactics should never be used in any match, much less a title match. I think the taste of the gold has gone to Dr. Death's head. I don't, like I said before, maybe he's being influenced by the wrong people.
Well, the thing about it, we know and stated earlier, Crusher Khrushchev, as he's turned his back on America, and of course, Steve Dr. Death Williams, Max America, he doesn't care for Khrushchev or he doesn't care for Terry Taylor, either one.
Khrushchev applying a chokehold. Carl Fergie trying to break it up now. Khrushchev's got him covered for a two count. A two count, Terry Taylor kicks out. And you know, the loss of blood in a match like this has got to start becoming a factor at this time. Boy, he's got him. He rolled him up. He's got him rolled up. One, two, a two count. And Terry Taylor hit Dr. Death right across the jawbone with a thundering forearm. I'm sure he's got to be pretty angry about going into that ring post. Dr. Death is dazed. Terry Taylor's got him rolled up.
He got him.
A three count. Terry Taylor retains the television championship. And now it's up to Dr. Death. He promised to give that medal back. He promised to give it back.
Terry Taylor is
hurt, but victorious. He is hurt, tired, exhausted. The loss of blood has got to be getting to him by now. Dr. Death, he promised to give the medal back. He's taking it off his neck now. It looks like he hit Terry Taylor right across the forehead with that medal.
And he did not do what he said he would do, Joel.
Well, we agree with the fans in that if you won something in the ring, that's where you should have to lose it. And we're certainly not going to condone somebody that tries to gain notoriety or fame by stealing what doesn't rightfully belong to him. And I'm a little bit disappointed in Doc, because when he won all his All-American honors at the University of Oklahoma, he won it on the playing field in football and on the mats in NCAA wrestling. And I'm sure that he would have been just as disappointed had somebody stolen one of those awards. So Terry, here's the TV title back that you so aptly won in the ring.
Well, thank you very much, Bill. It's been a long, long time coming, and I'm just glad. The quest for this gold medal, I don't know, it's taken me a long, long way down a long road. I want to thank all the fans for your support, and I just hope I can defend this title to the way that they would want me to.
Well, we'll be back with more action after these words from our Mid-South sponsors.
This event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. On my left in the blue corner, 210 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, Rocky Smith.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you're all familiar with my bodyguard, the man I hired because of all the loonies running around here, but I want to make one comment. I agree with Mid-South Wrestling for once. They have levied a $10,000 fine for anybody that uses a 2x4, just like Hacksaw Duggan does. They've levied a $10,000 fine for anybody that uses a chain, like the Junkyard Dog does. They've levied a $10,000 fine for anybody that uses a metal chair, like Sonny King does. Now, of course, they did agree to also levy a suspension on me if I use my racket, which I don't agree with, because how could a little tennis racket hurt somebody? But I've agreed to go along with it in the interest of fair play. I assure you, I agree with Mid-South 100%. We must have fair play. And as a matter of fact, in a related incident, I will be doing commentary on this match to give you an unbiased opinion on this man right here, my bodyguard, 268 pounds of unleashed fury, Hercules Hernandez.
Your referee for this event, Pee Wee Anderson.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you heard the comments of Jim Cornette, so I suppose I will have the privilege, for lack of a better term, of him joining me here at Mike's side to add his so-called expert commentary to this match.
It's so nice to have me, Jim Ross. It's so nice to have me.
Hercules.
And now you see Hercules Hernandez taking complete command of his opponent. You know, Hercules Hernandez had tremendous potential, and I saw that immediately as soon as I saw him. But the one thing that was lacking was a little bit of guidance, which I was able to offer. And I remember last week you were a little bit puzzled as to the name of his hold that he used, his new maneuver that he used to beat his opponent, the Shinonomaki. Is that right, Jim Ross?
That's exactly right. I certainly was.
Well, being a student of antiquity, I remembered that the Shinonomaki was developed by the ancient race of Mongolians in the Middle Ages as a means of hand-to-hand combat. The Orientals have always been masters of hand-to-hand combat. They used that in any instance where they needed to use guerrilla warfare without the use of weapons. The Shinonomaki cuts off the supply of blood to the brain through the carotid artery in the neck, just as any sleeper does, but it is a much more deadly version. You know, everybody thinks in a sleeper you go to sleep. You don't go to sleep, you go unconscious. It's just like if you and your tremendously bad physical condition stood up too fast, the blood rushes from your head and you nearly pass out. That's exactly what it is, Jim Ross. Another thing, the reason why Hercules Hernandez is my bodyguard, I want to remind everyone, is because Hacksaw Duggan is an idiot. He's a loony, he's a crazy man, and he's running around here trying to do me physical harm, and that's exactly why I've hired this man, because anybody that touches me will have to deal with him.
Well, there
it is, the Shinonomaki. And in addition, I understand that Joe Watts has been doing a lot of videos around here lately on the Fantastics and all these other people. They did one on Hacksaw Duggan, Jim Ross, but they can't show it because it reveals the fact that he can't beat anybody unless he uses a 2x4. I've heard this through my connections at the network. Right there, the Shinonomaki, the most feared hold in wrestling. It's dangerous in the hands of any man, but with arms like that, Hercules Hernandez's power, it's awesome, it's unstoppable. The Shinonomaki is unbreakable. I don't care who he puts it on, Jim Ross.
Well, Hercules Hernandez, in very impressive fashion, ladies and gentlemen, the victor in this match. He, of course, will have to wake up his opponent. That is part of the situation here.
He might. Now, you know what this is? A little massage to the side of the neck as well as a good hard blow restores that blood flow up through the carotid artery. It brings the blood back to the brain a little bit quicker. He's coming around here in a few minutes.
Ladies and gentlemen,
he'll be a little dizzy for a
while.
We'll
be back with more action right after this word from Mid-South Wrestling. Well, ladies and gentlemen, just as in any sport, there has to be rules and regulations that people have to abide by. And Mid-South makes every effort to maintain these rules. We have so many tremendously extroverted and aggressive athletes that sometimes it's virtually impossible to do. And when they ask for special matches with special stipulations and they sign those matches, both parties agree to suffer the consequences as they were. Well, in relationship to these tremendous rule breaks, these tremendous things that have happened right here on television, Cowboy Bill Watts has made a special statement, and he's also had a very special interview with Sonny King. Let's see that now.
You know, Sonny, in the 1960s when I got into wrestling, it seems like wrestling was outgrowing the rules and regulations. And, you know, the other night I was watching the Olympics, and a guy said gymnastics, that the sport of gymnastics has outgrown the way of scoring, that the way of scoring is antiquated. When I got in wrestling in the 1960s, if two guys got in a fight, then broke the rules, they brought it back in a no disqualification match and they settled the issue. And wrestling promoters and associations have tried to enforce rules and regulations, but it seems like the wrestlers have always wanted to leave the scope of what the rules and regulations were in order to settle the issue, to make it more exciting, to make it a bigger gamble, or to finally injure somebody and put them out of business. They've always sought for that final match that would settle the issue. In the 1960s, there came the Texas Death Match. Falls don't count, no disqualification, 30 seconds between falls, goes to one man, couldn't answer the bell. Then in 1970, there was a Brass Knucks Championship declared with Sputnik Monroe and a vivid and colorful history. In 1973, I, with Dusty Rhodes, we developed a bunkhouse match. Come as dressed as you are, your cowboy boots, your buckles, whatever. Then in 1974, Dusty Rhodes made history with a bull rope match. Two guys tied together with a bull riding rope. Then in 1976, I guess I got a lot of national publicity for walking tall against Abdullah the Butcher in Atlanta, Georgia. 1979, the JYD developed the dog collar match. First time ever against Bob Sweetan in 1982 in the Superdome, a ghetto street fight, Junkyard Dog and Reed. Then in 1983, Hacksaw Dugan came up with the Coal Miner's Glove match. All these different matches increase the specter of violence, increase the danger of risk, but it's all based upon one guy wanting to get rid of the other guy and not have any rules and regulations. Then 3 weeks ago, I guess the straw that broke the camel's back, as you went in the ring after Dugan brought a 2x4 in, and it got taken away from him, and you're the guy that got injured. Let's look at that.
Hacksaw Jim Duggan's got the 2x4. Landell's got his feet. Hernandez has got the 2x4. We've got more action. Hernandez
looks as if he doesn't know who to knock out with that board.
Hernandez.
Sonny King.
Hernandez with a vicious blow. That 2x4. Sonny King. Hernandez is working over Sonny King with the board. The referee's trying to restore some sort of order.
He's been hit three times across the shoulder area with that 2x4.
And there, Sonny King, you did what is probably the most noble sacrifice of all you sacrificed for your brother. Even though he brought the 2x4 in the ring, and definitely Hernandez was trying to injure him, he vented his anger on you, and you've been on the shelf for 3 weeks.
That's right, Bill. You know what has been going on around here, and you know how things are set up. And I know what goes on in those guys' dressing room. I'm one of the guys that have been there before, and I know exactly what their thoughts are and what they're trying to do, Bill. And I knew. See, professional wrestling, everybody asks you, is what you do on TV, is it real? People, I'm sitting here with a dislocated shoulder. I want to tell you that it's 3 weeks of my living is down the drain. This is for real. Bill, I realized what was going on, but I thought at the moment it was the proper thing to do. And I want to say to you that I like Hacksaw Dugan. I don't blame him for what he was trying to do. And it's become, like you said, it become a time when the wrestlers, just like the fan, they feel like we got to get rid of these people. So how do you go by doing it? And they just get, and these are the ideas to get.
Well, I want to say one thing. It seems like with the dog, it's the chain. With me, it was a 2x4. With Dugan, it's a 2x4.
Yeah.
It seems like Cornette and some of these guys do have valid reasoning, but whatever. We can't stop it all. Mid-South knows that. But we are going to make it a $10,000 fine for anybody that brings a 2x4, a steel chair, a chain, or a tennis racket, Jim Cornette, to the ring and hits somebody with the object, unless it's one of these matches that we have no control over that are outside the rules and regulation. If somebody brings, it's going to be a $10,000 fine, or they're going to leave Mid-South. And that's just, we can't stop everything, but we got to try to stop it before somebody is critically injured or permanently injured. And of course, what is the status of your injury? When do you think you'll be back?
Well, Bill, I'm not going to say. It's a secret between myself and my doctor. Every night, I'm going to honor my contracts. I'm going to show up to all the arenas, and I'm going to be there. Only me and my docs know when I'm ready. But Bill, I would tell you this, like I've said before, I will be there, and when the opportunity come up, I will take advantage of it, and I guarantee you. For all of the tickets that the people have bought, my name was on a contract, and I didn't get in and give you a match. I will honor all of those contracts. I'm going to wrestle each one of these people that I was supposed to wrestle, and I'm also going to give you the big surprise of your lifetime, because, Bill, I've been down before. People all over the country read about it. I survived it. I came back. I told my kid when he came to intensive care and looked down in my face and I started crying. He says, Daddy, are you going to ever be able to wrestle again? And I said to my kid, he's now 10 years old, I says, Larry, Daddy, get back up and make you proud of him. And Bill, when you do that for your kid, you got something to live for.
We'll be back after these words from Jim Ross and Joel Watts.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the way that I read that situation, of course, the announcement of Cowboy Bill Watts is crystal clear about the $10,000 fine. But I also think we need to keep in mind that Sonny King intends to keep the pressure on his perpetrators. I think that it's very obvious that he's going to keep his physical status a deep secret between him and his physician. And it looks to me like Sonny King is preparing to attack without warning. Sonny King is a man to be reckoned with. And now let's go to our ring announcer, Boyd Pierce.
This tag team event, one fall, 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, 265 pounds from Tuscaloosa, Alabama, Big Bad Bob Owens. And his team partner, Atlanta, Georgia, 225 pounds, Tim Horton.
Hey,
Their opponents in the ring, Tommy Rogers and Bobby Fulton, the Fantastics.
The Fantastics making their way to the ring with their traditional ZZ Top music, going against Big Bad Bob Owens.
Well, the Fantastics certainly make a flashy entrance, but you know, when they get those tuxedo tops off, they can still back it up with their athletic talent.
There's the bell from referee Ron West. Tim Horton is the partner of Bob Owens. It'll be Fulton and Owens starting out the action. The Fantastics, and they are indeed that, ladies and gentlemen, top tag team contenders. It's very obvious. Great drop kick by Rogers. They get better every week. They are lightning fast and so very, very explosive.
Both of them, Jim, are tremendous athletes. And you know, when you're talking about tremendous athletes, it brings to mind Kerry Von Erich and Ric Flair. You know, I'd like to wish Kerry the very best of luck in his quest for the goal to regain that title from now the world's champion Ric Flair. He kind of got a raw deal, so to speak, in Japan when Ric Flair won the title back from him. And I certainly wish him the best of luck in his upcoming title defense.
Rogers came exploding. He exploded off that second rope.
Tommy Rogers went completely across the ring and landed on Tim Horton.
We talked about him being explosive. And ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back with Steve Dr. Death Williams right after this.
Event, one fall, 10-minute time limit, in the red corner, at 270 pounds, former Oklahoma University football star, and now top-ranked wrestler, Dr. Death Steve Williams. And in the blue corner, at 226 pounds, his opponent from Salem, Virginia, Rick McCard. Carl Fergie, your referee.
This match, one fall, the 10-minute time limit. Steve Dr. Death Williams will be going against Rick McCord, and there's the bell. You know, as Joe Watts mentioned just a little bit earlier, we do want to wish Kerry Von Erich our very best. Mid-South had a very instrumental part in securing a neutral site for this rematch as a result of what many experts consider to be a little foul play in Japan. And that match will be coming up next week, ladies and gentlemen, so don't miss that one. And speaking of great matches and great talent, Steve Dr. Death Williams possesses a tremendous amount of talent, four-time All-American on the wrestling mat, and a football animal.
Terrific shoulder block. Steve Williams showing that football prowess. You know, another pair of great athletes are coming up. The Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Duggan going against the Midnight Express, and that's bound to be wild and woolly because it's another one of those matches where, of course, it's no disqualification. So the referee doesn't have a whole lot of control over it. It's one of those type things where they just want to go toe-to-toe, so to speak, and get things settled between them.
We've talked about the no disqualification clauses. Once those contracts are signed, both teams have to suffer the consequences, and there's a lot of hatred, a lot of animosity that will be displayed in that match coming up next. But focusing right back on the squared circle, we've got a very physical Steve Dr. Death Williams, tremendously strong, and he is so very, very physical. Ladies and gentlemen, and Joel, the thing about this, Dr. Death is so young, he is getting better and better every week.
Yes, he's certainly improved weekly, as you say, Jim, now that he's been in the professional ranks. It just took a little bit of time to hone all that raw talent that he's got into the wrestling machine that he has become.
He picks the cord up just like a rag doll. He's got him set for the stampede.
Oh! He just about drove him through those 2x4s, and that'll be all for Rick McCord.
Dr. Death with an awesome victory, and ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back. JYD and Hacksaw Duggan go for the Mid-South tag titles. No disqualification coming up next.
This event for the Mid-South Tag Team.
Boy, you look like an explosion in a fireworks plant. Ladies and gentlemen, you are privileged tonight, beyond all other nights, to see the greatest Mid-South Tag Team Championship match that you will ever see in your entire life. And I,
Wait, just hold this for me just a second. Boyd, I got something I got to do.
Wrestling fans, this is one fall. Our television time remaining. Mid-South Tag Team Championship is on the line. There's no disqualification. Now, if Jim Cornette will come back.
Okay, I just had a couple of things I had to take care of. You know, my bodyguard, Hercules Hernandez, I trust him completely. Any investment, any purchase that my mother and I want to make, any cash that we have to be handled, I trust him fully to do it. I don't even need my bodyguard at ringside tonight because Hacksaw Duggan's going to be in this match, and he's the reason I have to have one in the first place. But I will introduce to you the most awesome combination in wrestling, the number one cause of divorce in America today, Loverboy Dennis and beautiful Bobby, the Midnight Express. Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Jim Duggan. No disqualification.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, there you see it, the four competitors in our television main event. And without a doubt, this would be a main event in any arena in the country. The Mid-South Tag Team titles will be on the line. No disqualification. They signed the contracts, and here we go with one of the greatest main events we've ever had here on Mid-South.
You're 100% right, Jim. I think Grizzly Smith has really outdone himself this time with this match. As Bobby Eaton with a hard right cross to JYD doesn't seem to faze him too much. And, you know, something I noted, Jim, is JYD, in the absence of his that ever-present chain that's been around his neck for years and years here in the Mid-South, is now gone because of the recent furor over the $10,000 fine.
Well, chain or no chain, 2x4 or no 2x4, the Junkyard Dog and Hacksaw Jim Duggan are an awesome force to reckon with. Cornette and his team know that. They're sitting on top of the mountain right now.
There's no doubt about that. I believe Jim Cornette has got to be concerned at this point. He's got a lot of confidence in his team's quickness and their great shape, their aerobic conditioning, but here on television with the shorter time limit, it seems that may work to their disadvantage.
Duggan with that clothesline, and he nailed Condrick. Duggan and the Dog with an obvious size and strength advantage. The Midnight Express are going to have to tag in and out quickly, and thus far they have not had that opportunity.
Duggan and Dog now working together is quite a good team, you see.
There's that save. Now that would have been a disqualification, but there are no disqualifications in this match. I'll say this at the outset, referee Pee-wee Anderson has really got his hands full. As a former official myself, you really feel helpless in those situations.
Pee-wee's obviously doing his best, but there's only so much you can do in an ODQ bout.
Over the top!
Throws Bobby Eaton over that top rope.
Out to the concrete he goes. Remember, no disqualification, ladies and gentlemen, in this match.
Duggan's such a powerful individual. He and the Junkyard Dog both. It seems now Jim Cornette's looking pretty concerned.
Well, he should be concerned at this point in time because his champions have not really been on the offensive yet. Remember, this is one fall or TV time remaining.
And you know, Jim, it pleases me to see the absence of Hercules Hernandez. He could certainly become a factor in a no DQ bout.
Duggar twirled him around like a rag doll, and then he slams him viciously.
Duggan with a tremendous elbow. Tremendous elbow. Bobby Eaton now in a lot of pain. Duggan hesitating, though. That might have been a slight tactical error on Duggan's part. I'm sure he knows what he's doing, though.
Snapmare by the dog. The dog with that big old right hand. It found a home on the forehead of beautiful Bobby. And look at Condry, somewhat hesitant. And who can blame him about stepping in there with a mad dog? The Junkyard Dog, one of the strongest men in all of wrestling. Condry may have fallen right to the trap, and the dog's so strong.
Condry's gonna have to pull something out of his hat. Dog with that patented headbutt. Lateral press, two. Dennis Condry kicked out. Another two count. Dennis Condry, a strong man himself.
Been not impressed. Both men are in great shape. The dog with a
Junkyard Dog. That was about a 2 3/4 count there. Bobby Eaton now trying to hedge the rules a little bit while Pee-wee Anderson had his back turned.
As I said, the referee has one pair of eyes. He's trying to stay on four men in the court with Cornette, maybe four and a half men. Dog powers out.
Bobby Eaton going for that quick fall. I think he might have underestimated the dog just a slight bit.
Now you see the Midnight Express at their best. Working in their half of the ring, tagging in and out very quickly.
The action is just so intense, Jim Ross. This has got to be one of the most exciting matches I've ever seen on Mid-South.
Here comes the Hacksaw. He's walking tall.
And the fans are really going wild.
Now we've got all four of them in there.
It had to happen sooner or later, Jim Ross. In a no DQ bout with this kind of tempers flaring. These men are going after it now.
The dog at Cornette. Cornette has pounded the dog's eyes and Dugan's chasing him right out.
Junkyard Dog is blinded.
The referee goes out. JY is blinded. Condry's on the floor. We've got bodies everywhere.
Hacksaw Duggan now trying to put the coup de grace on Bobby Eaton. But Pee-wee Anderson's not there to make it the count. He's out on the floor writhing in pain.
And JYD's blinded, and Condry's trying to take over on him.
Pee-wee Anderson is really hurt.
Cornette goes for an awkward elbow and he hit his own man, and now Duggan's got Cornette.
Duggan's got Cornette.
JYD's blinded on the floor and he's fighting with Cornette doing the best he can. And Duggan's choking the life out of Cornette. Here's Hernandez.
Hernandez has got that coal miner's glove. I thought Khrushchev had the coal miner's glove. Hernandez just waylaid Hacksaw Duggan with that coal miner's glove. And there's Hernandez and Cornette trying to revive Pee-wee Anderson, who's finally made it back into the ring.
JYD was blinded outside. Hernandez came in with a coal miner's glove, and he leveled Duggan. The winners of the match, remember, it was no disqualification. The Midnight Express, the winners. We've got scheduled to have Tony Torres against Hans Schroeder
coming up next.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're here at ringside. Mr. Cornette has a statement about the rules. You're a fine one to talk about the rules.
About the rules, exactly right. Listen to my voice. He's already damaged my vocal cords. Let me tell you something. True or false, am I telling a lie? Hacksaw Duggan and Junkyard Dog were the ones that asked for no disqualification, right?
That's exactly right.
That's exactly right, because they wanted to declare open season on me. They wanted to get me. We wanted to wrestle with honor, defend our belts by the rules, be a credit to the sport of wrestling in the Mid-South Territory. But they demanded no disqualification, so that means that they got what they deserved. There's a $10,000 fine for the boards, the chairs, the chains. Nobody said anything about a glove, did they, Jim Ross? Nobody said anything about a glove.
First say no.
Nobody said anything. Next, they're going to tell us what brand of underwear we can wear to the ring. The whole thing's nonsense in the first place, but nobody said anything about a glove. They demanded it, so they got what's coming to them. Because let me tell you one thing above all else. Anybody who tries to outsmart Jim Cornette is going to have the tables turned on him in a fitting manner. I can guarantee you that right now.
Well, that's Mr. Cornette's version of his interpretation of the rules. And we'll be back with a great tag team match right after this.
This is a standby bout. One fall or television time remaining. A tag team match in the red corner. From California, Nature Boy Buddy Landell. And his team partner, the Russian sympathizer Crusher Khrushchev. And Coco Ware, the pretty young thing. Your referee, Carl Berge.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we do not have a great deal of time. The competitors have been notified of the time. They will be going for it. You can bet on that. Two outstanding tag team combinations. Landell and Khrushchev going against the PYT, Coco Ware and Norvell Austin.
Yes, Grizzly Smith has informed us that if there is a draw in this match, he will try to get the bout rescheduled for next week, which would be really great, seeing as how it is such a great main event.
Well, the men have been notified, as I mentioned, of the lack of time remaining. They are going to go for the downs, no doubt about that. And don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, right here next week, a very, very special feature, a workout with the North American champion, Magnum TA, Terry Taylor, and Tommy Rogers. That should be exciting. That will happen next week. Coco Ware and Norvell Austin now tagging in and out quickly. They have had the most experience, but obviously working as a unit. We have 2 minutes of television time remaining.
Just as you said, Jim Ross, both Coco Ware and Norvell Austin have spent a great deal of time in professional wrestling, specifically working as a unit. And you know where they came from, Memphis, Tennessee, it wasn't past them to hedge the rules a little bit. They weren't exactly always the crowd favorite.
They are certainly tough competitors, and so is Landell, like a little shark taking advantage. He'll stand in the wings, and when you least expect it, there he is. Landell goes to deliver the coup de grace, but he went to the well, and it was dry.
So I think there's a whole lot of Jim Cornette in Nature Boy Buddy Landell, and that he is just as devious as he is a good athlete.
Norvell Austin, side headlock, it takes Landell over.
Of course, I don't mean to insinuate in any way that Jim Cornette is a great athlete.
Our director, Oral Inc., has notified us we are under 1 minute, ladies and gentlemen.
Norvell Austin's neck was dropped right across that steel cable. He's obviously hurt.
Landell tagging out. In comes the powerful Russian sympathizer, Crusher Khrushchev.
Khrushchev now trying to take advantage of that injury to Norvell Austin.
Ladies and gentlemen, 30 seconds left. There's a tag. Here comes Coco. Coco Ware cleaning house.
He's really taking it to Landell and Khrushchev.
Dropkick. He was in the lights.
Tremendous.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have less than 15 seconds left. For Boyd Pierce, Joel Watts, I'm Jim Ross, saying thanks for being with us. And we'll see you right here next week for another exciting hour. We'll try to have this match back. We'll see you next week on Mid-South Wrestling.